So, hello and thanks for still being around. So today I'm going to talk about PetitParser, but before I start into that, just have a question. So who here is comfortable? So you, okay, you're comfortable, you have a nice place. Okay, cool. So whoever wants to be here for this tutorial, this is a hands-on tutorial. So I would like to get up and find pairs. So nobody, and if you want, if you find a pair, then next to each other. So please sit next to each other. Right? We want to, so please go there, find a pair. Or if you, if it's possible, also, you know, in the process, maybe coming closer so that like this we can have better interaction and talk with people. No? Okay, you're that comfortable. Okay. Okay, so who does not want to participate? You don't want to participate? Fine. Who else doesn't want to participate? I just want to know. It's not a problem if you don't want to participate. It's fine. Yeah, that's better. Yes, exactly. We have to work today, yes. So the main reason why I want you to pair up, the main reason why I want you to pair up is because I don't want to do the work. That's basically it. So I would like you to work on something. So we will program. So we have like 3 hours approximately with a break in between, and we will program for the most of the time, hopefully. Okay? So just a bit of introduction. So I'll be talking about PetitParser. Question? No question. Okay. By the way, questions are welcome at any time. So PetitParser is a super cool engine. It was built by Lukas Renggli, and I'm really happy to be talking about it. And I tell you why. Because until about, let's say, 1.5 years ago, I was parsing challenged. So how many of you here are not parsing challenged? Well, basically, you know the answer to this question if you answer to the following question. How many of you here have ever built a parser? Okay. A working parser? Okay. Now, mostly everybody else is, it could fall into the category of parsing challenged, right? So my idea is, I was parsing challenged in the sense that I was hardly, you know, it was very hard for somebody to convince me to approach a parsing problem, right? And everything changed since I got the blue pill. Right? So this is what I want to convince you that PetitParser is. It's a super cool thing. And if you like Smalltalk, it's even better because it's super deeply integrated with Smalltalk. Right? It's just beautiful. And, well, yeah, it's also part of the Moose suite. I sent you an email with the link. So everybody got that? Everybody downloaded the image? So who did not download the image? Okay. Do you see the mail in the mailing list? So there is one. There should be one to the participants' mailing list, right? Please download that one. One should be enough for a pair, okay? Ideally, but if you want to maybe try something, then we can see. Okay, so hey, that one, right? So how many of you are still having problems with identifying the image? You still have problems identifying the image? Does Janik have a problem identifying the image? Hmm? Exactly. Oh, I forgot to mention that now that you have beautifully built a custom cog VM, right? You can use that one to run this beautiful image. Right? And this, it will only run with the cog VM. Okay, are there other issues? like technical issues. No, okay, we can move on. Great. Now, so for those that don't know what, so who here says that knows what parsing is? Okay. Now, who does not know exactly what parsing is? Okay, one, two. So, okay, from those that know that parsing is, what is parsing? So, so who wants to answer the question of what is parsing? Not you two. Somebody else? Yes, somebody. What is parsing?
I might not know, though.
Yeah, I know, but I don't want to embarrass you.
All right.
No, seriously. Anybody, what is parsing? Extracting semantics or, well, yeah, probably. Right, so you, yes?
It's decomposing an input string according to the rules of the grammar and identifying whether the string conforms to the grammar or not. And if it does conform to the grammar, it decomposes the string into components of the grammar.
Right. So basically, essentially, what it is, right, you get an input, you put it into a machine, and you get an output, right? This is what it all is about, right? Exactly. This is what it said, right? So parsing is that, okay? So what we're going to do today, we're going to just jump into it, right? So this is what we want to do. We want to take a look at PetitParser. The target for today is to actually build a real, or at least a grammar, okay? To check whether the input is correct. And that is the grammar that we're going to tackle. And this is one test case that we're going to write, right? So if you would open the workspace and you will type this MSE matches and this particular string and you evaluate that, it should return true. Of course, hopefully, there is no true nice implementation of matches. But OK, so you should actually implement this in your grammar. OK? And then we will see. We will see how it develops, and then we'll see how many other things we build on top of that. Okay, this is the target. This is how it can look like, but I'm not going to show it to you. Now, so before we go on and say, you know, what is, you know, what do we do with PetitParser and so on, let's take a quick look at what is actually, you know, deeper a bit into what is a parser. So we start first with the like Elliot said, right, it's about a grammar. So there must be some sort of a description of the input language. So we have, in that case, is identifier, which is a letter, or, and then followed by either a letter or a digit multiple times. This is what that grammar says. Everybody comfortable with reading that one? Right, who's not comfortable reading that that grammar? Okay, that's great. So, of course, then you can look at it like this, right? So you can look at it as a machine that says, well, okay, the first thing, I should take a look at something A to Z. And then either I go A to Z, or I don't have anything, and I go at the end. Or I can have a digit, and then I can do this over again, or I finish, right? This is how you can classically see a grammar. Now, the thing here is that the way this would look in Smalltalk, I said that PetitParser is deeply embedded into Smalltalk. The thing this looks in Smalltalk is like this. Like a couple of, you know, bits and syntactic sugar around it. But other than that, it's plain Smalltalk. Okay? So basically, we will have something, an identifier parser, that says it's a letter, followed, right, so the comma, followed by either a letter or a digit multiple times. Right, so this is how it used to be in this abstract notation, right? This is how it is in Smalltalk. Isn't it cool? I think it's cool. It's really cool. Now, this is not all, right? So it's not just the API that is really cool. So I said it's embedded into Smalltalk. So first of all, right, first is this nice fluent API of composing things. But the coolest thing is the approach to parsing, right? And then seeing parsing not as a sequence necessarily of rules, but as a composition of objects. So now, before we go into that, I would like you to open the image. That's the first exercise. Open the image. Type these parts, right? So identifier, letter as parser, hash letter as parser, parentheses star, and evaluate it on different kinds of strings. see how that works. Okay, questions? So if you have at any moment questions, please raise your hand. And then we will ask the questions publicly. And ideally, we will have somebody else in the room answer your question. Okay, this is the, that'll be the goal of it. Okay, so let's jump in. Okay, so you have about 3 minutes. Yes, please, Mariano.
Why the star was reified, put the name star as the selector and slash? In the previous example, come back. Yeah. There was no way to override something.
What is the question first?
Elliot knows.
Right, so Elliot knows already, and even if we don't know what the question is.
Why can't you use star? Because star is a binary selector, and this is Smalltalk.
Yes, exactly.
So star is a unary operator there, so you have to map it to a unary selector.
Yeah, but why is it doing it in Smalltalk?
If you don't accept my answer.
No, slash. So wait, slash is a binary operator, right? In here.
Yeah.
So vertical slash is a binary operator. Star is a unary operator.
So, okay.
Right? So you cannot put star in there because
Smalltalk. It's not about using some stupid BNF by some little
Right. But wait, who's already finished? I want you to open the image now, please. Right? Open the image, open a workspace, and type this thing in. Please. Right, so we want to have, well, you know, as if you can look at it, it's just the only difference is the string here, right? So we just, I just want you to go and have a feeling, right? So just start, it's basically a very simple parser of parsing an identifier, right? In a regular language. Who's done? Okay, cool, we have a winner here, and we have a winner here. Very good. You're done there? Very cool. Who else? You're done there? Very cool. Hey, you guys are talking too much. Who's done there? They're done. Okay, very good. What about in the back? How do we stand there? We finished before we started. I don't believe you. Let me check that. I want to check that. Let me see. Oh, very good. They did. Is it fine? You ready? Let me check these guys. How do we stand? You got it?
Yeah.
Very good. Did you get it? Very good. Okay. I don't think you need it, but no. Yeah. How about you? Is it fine? Excellent. So, anybody got an exception until now? Anybody an exception? No exception? How can it be that easy? I must be. So yeah, that's the point. You know, it should be really fun to start building a parser, right? That's the point. Okay, now let's take a look a bit inside. Let's learn, you know, what it is, right? So we were talking about selectors and see what it is. So this is one way of looking at it. And from the API point of view, you will perceive your grammar like this, like a succession of rules. But if you implement it, and I want you to actually I want you to not just experience PetitParser from outside. I would like to go inside a bit, not too much, but I will go with you a bit and help have you browse a bit the structure and the implementation of PetitParser, just to have a feeling of what it is inside, and see how easy it actually can be. It's amazing. So. The first thing we do is realize that actually we don't want this at the implementation level. We want this at the implementation level. So instead of having rules, we want to decompose things into objects. So basically, everything that you see in here is an object. It's a Smalltalk object. So let's read this. So first we say, well, at the grand level, we have a letter. As a parser, this is this one. Then this is followed, right? So we have a sequence here. Then we have many, right? The star at that level. We have many, the operator.
What isn't it any?
No, many because it's star.
But star is zero or more.
No, it just doesn't matter. Okay, we can call it star. Right, zero or more, right? That's what I want to say there. And then we have a choice, right, inside. And the choice is between a letter and a digit. This is the machinery that we have inside. Okay? So now, if, again, when you say letter as parser, I would like you to now select letter as parser and inspect that. What do you get? It's a predicate object, right? So not character, not just letter, because that is a character. But we have as parser, right? So we have to evaluate the whole thing. Okay, so then you have the predicate object. Now, so first of all, right, we have parsers as objects. And the way you compose, the way you get, though, to this, right? So we have basic objects for everything. And then you can compose them, and then you have a larger object. So let's see, what kind of actions can we have? So we have, first of all, we have the terminals, right? So we have terminal C, which is one single, or like a terminal character, which is one single character. We have a string, which is, it matches that particular string. We have any, which matches any character, any input character. We have a digit, so hash digit. As parser will give you a parser that will parse only digits. And we have letters. Yes?
So is there any thought to extending it to parsing binary streams?
Thank you. So we leave it at the end?
Yeah.
Right. So because the point of PetitParser is not, it's about streams. It has nothing to do with character. It has nothing to do with strings, right? So you just have an input stream. You can even put full-fledged objects in there, and then. But the only thing is that you will have to write your own parsers for that, right? So now we want to go and see what is a parser. You know, how is this going on, and where are these things defined? So I want you to now open your system browsers and browse PP predicate object parser. Okay? On the class side, you find all these utility methods. Right? So for example, you have digit here. This is the this is what gets invoked when you say digit, a hash digit as parser. And as you see, this one returns a character, a char set predicate. Just browse around. So I want you to take a couple of minutes and browse the protocol factory cars. Okay? Mm-hmm. Questions? So you will see that everywhere you see here, right? So this is what you will say. So if you do any of this, so if you do hash LF as parser, you will get that object. If you do hash lowercase as parser, you will get that object, and so on, right? This is like a factory. It's on the class side, so it's just a factory of convenience parsers, right? But you'll be able to, the whole machinery is there for you to implement your own parsers if you want to. That's really the cool thing, where the cool thing is. Okay, so, yes? PP predicate object parser on the class side,
okay.
Factory cars, no problem. This is basically a part. This is where the terminals, like the default terminals, are there for you to use, right? Just convenience methods, basically,
right,
to make the whole thing easier. But everything is object, so hence it's totally extensible.
Was there a debate, a fight over whether to call it predicate object or predicate terminal? Or just object was obviously the right choice?
Well, we have to see. I think that once Lukas mentioned that he talks sometimes in the mirror, but usually, I believe that the fight was quite brief. Yeah. So after he finished this, we basically, I think I just looked at it a bit, played a bit with it. I think I maybe we have brushed like one selector or two. We had a bit of a debate over negate or not, and that was it. Very, very few things to change. Okay, so are we done here? Yeah? No? Okay, cool. So this is one. Now, so these are the like the basic things that you can use directly on strings, right? The char, the different terminals. Now we want to be able to combine and do something with them, right? So we have the combinators. Yes, question.
It's just Igor just showed me something outrageously cool, which is have a look at symbol as parser method, and then it makes sense how the two are.
Oh, right, exactly. Well, let's do that. So we have.
You don't see anything.
I know you don't. I'm working on it. So this is what it is to it, right? So there's nothing but a delegate. So every time you do a special out of these symbols, it just delegates to whatever you need it to be. And that's it. Okay? Okay. So as I said, now we have the terminals. Now we should be able to combine them, right? So where is this? Yes? Question.
It doesn't make any difference between lexical and
syntactical. Yes.
Right.
I should have. But that's why I said, right? Forget what you know what the classic approach, right, to it is. We're not talking about research now, so I'm not going to pretend that these things have never been done before, right? So this is canonless parsing for those that want to know that. But it's just, you know, if you take a look at it from inside out, it's just natural. Well, you just take a look at it at something that just traverses a certain stream. Apply some rules, and poof, you get an output, and that's it. Okay? Okay, so now, are we ready? We have the terminals, now we have to move up a bit, and start to introduce the combinators. So we have the sequence, right? We have the choice, we have the star, we have, let's say, plus, and we have optional, for example. Star and plus.
So that is 0 or 1.
So challenge now. What's the difference between star and plus, right? So I'm not going to answer that because you already know how to answer it yourself. And I'm going to teach you how. So first I want you to acknowledge that there's also this thing which are called predicates. So we talk about not, negate, and. We will talk a bit about them a bit later. So the next thing I want you to do is open the browser on PetitParser on the instance side and browse the operations protocol. Okay? So the background question is what's the difference between star and plus? That's the background question. Okay? So are we there? Everybody's there? I want to know. Okay, cool. Right? So, first of all, every parser will inherit from PPParser, okay? And everything that there is basically to do with the parser will be implemented in this superclass. So like this, you will be able to combine or operate on top of your existing parser, any of the subclasses. Right? So here you have, right? The comma is there, the sequence is there, the choice is there. Right? These are just different parsers. Now let's take a quick look at the difference between star and plus. So I will browse this one as well. And I will be looking for star. So here it says repeating parser on self. And I will take a look at plus, which says self minimum 1. Okay, so I don't know what that is, so let me check what minimum 1 is. Oh, it's also a repeating parser on self, but it has this minimum something. So let me now browse what I would normally do. I will just browse the PP repeating parser. So now I'm browsing PP repeating parser. I'm going on the class side. So let's see. So we have on minimum, we have self on a parser, set minimum, maximum, right? So it's from the minimum that I specify to the largest possible value, right? So to infinite. And on here would say It's from minimum zero, right, to the maximum.
So if you parse a large enough file,
you will have a problem in this case, right? If you parse large enough files, you can notice here that this is like the default, the most logical default value. But there's nothing to say that you shouldn't be able to use the largest implementation of an integer you can find.
More appropriate value is will be minus one.
No, definitely not. That's also true, right?
You can have floating.
Right. So now, if you want to know how this is implemented, basically we'll have to look at this parse on method, which sometimes is a bit of a magic going on over there. But if you really put your mind to it, you can go and read it, right? But even now, right, if we just read the comment here, a parser that eagerly parses minimum to max instances of my delegate. Okay, so this is the answer to your question. Star was starting from 0, the default one, plus started, Star started from 0 and plus started from minimum 1, right?
And optional as maximum 1.
Optional exactly as a maximum 1, right? So as a maximum 1, so 0 or 1, between 0 and 1. So that's the answer to your question. Right? And if you want some fancier API that would match better your situation, you can just implement that operator. And that's just totally fine. This is why I love it. Okay?
So, just one question. I don't like that this method is a bit big to my sense.
That's fine. So we would welcome your refactoring. Right. Other questions? Wait, no more other questions? All right, so this is how you read the parser, right? So the parsers are already there. You look in petit parsers, parser, category parsers, all the subclasses of PP parser, and these are all the different kinds of logical parsers that can be then instantiated with different parameters. Like we saw here, the repeating parser takes two parameters, the minimum and the maximum. Okie dokie. Yes?
I think there is a BNF parser.
In petit parser?
Yes.
No, I'm not sure. But that would be really cool, and actually we wanted to have an NTLR parser that produces petit parser implementations already. That would be really a great project, yes. That would be great. So this is the basic of petit parser. So basically everything else is just there. It's right there for you to read. He took all this great amount of time to write all these beautiful comments, which most of the time are just enough for you to understand. So just read on the class comment, and you pretty much get an idea of what that thing does. So I'd suggest, let's jump into it. So I want you now, in the same workspace though, I want you to have, I would like to have this thing executed and producing that. Right? So I want, you can see this is a variable, right, in your workspace. You just don't see the code above it. Right? So I want you now to fill the code above it with the appropriate implementation such that when you execute string parser, string parse string, it will return you that as a printout. Right? So now, what is string? Right? What's the implementation of string? So it gets a bit tricky. Let's see who's first. Yes, I want you to implement that, right? We're not joking here. So here we say, I have here one, two, three quotes, right? So basically that means I want to just have quote, some string, quote, right? But in Smalltalk, I would have to write it as I have to escape the quote, right? So it will be string parse, blah, blah, string. So Who's onto it? How would you implement that? Yes. I don't understand anything, right? Yeah. It's okay. Ask the question.
I'm confused. I'm confused. Because,
right.
Because I see string as the instance variable, so I want to put, or the temporary variable, I want to put something into it.
Yeah, this is what I want you to do.
But then you have this script, then you're parsing.
Right, so what I did, I played a trick on you, and then I implemented it, and then I deleted it, and I took the screenshot.
I know, but I'm trying to get the structure.
Right, so first you initialize string, and then you run that one there, and then you execute it, and after you executed it, you must have that. I'm coming to you. Yes, are you ready? So who else is ready? We have a winner here. When were you ready, now or before?
Before.
Before, okay, so it's a tie. Okay, cool. You're lost.
Yeah, as soon as I tried to leave something complicated.
Exactly, but is this complicated? It's not complicated, it's really easy. Yes?
The exercise for strings that includes digits or not?
It just includes anything, right? It's a string, right? So you should know the definition of a string. So by the way, what is the definition of a string? We have the question here. What is the definition of a string? How would you write the grammar for that? So you implement this. How did you write that?
We had a tick in the beginning.
So you have a character. Part, and then in between?
Word. We put any as parser.
Any as parser. Well, let's see.
To exclude. Right.
So how did you exclude that?
Well, the particular example didn't.
Right. So let's see. Right. So can anybody dictate what I should type it in here? I'm fine. I'm going to help you, right? I just pushed you a bit into a cold water, and all of a sudden you're just crying already. Let's take it easy, relax, right? I understand it can be really daunting. But that's why I want you to do it, right? So, everybody with me? Our goal is to have something like this. We have a string as a parser. We want to send parse to it. Then we will place inside a string, right? Like something like that, or let's put the X, Y, Z. And then when we will print this, we want this to work, right? This is the goal. So let's see, what does that mean? So how is this working? So who has done anything until now? Who's working on it? 1, 2, 3, 4. Anybody else managed? Anybody else still trying? Who's still trying? Okay, you're still trying and you finished. That's cool.
No,
I'm joking. Okay, so those that are still trying, could we please pay attention a bit?
Yeah.
So those that finish, can you tell me what I should write in here? What should I write?
Dollar
quote, right? S parse, right? Afterwards?
Comma.
So hang on. What I wrote was dollar tick as parser not star, and it doesn't work. Why not? Dollar tick as parser.
And afterwards?
It doesn't work. It jams.
This one jams, right?
Dollar tick as
parser. Because not the
half. No.
It doesn't work. It's cool.
Yeah, wait. So, anybody else has another opinion as to the implementation?
Negate.
Yes?
Negate.
No, wait. No, you're not you. Anybody else? So, what were your... Who says negate? Yeah, but he says negate, I don't know why. Who else other implementation? So you had another implementation. You put what in there?
You use identifier.
Right. So what was that? Let's say letter? Something like this?
No, yes.
Awesome.
No, wait. So what is another implementation until now? Right, but letter star or something like that. Anybody else used another keyword there? Yeah, I understand that. Anybody else? So you were finishing first. What did you use in the middle? You put any, right? So there was another one for any.
Yeah, I know. But any.
right? So something like this, right? So now let's take a look here. Basically, right, so this doesn't really work because then we would also be allowed to put one single string in there, right? That's not good. It doesn't work. This is not enough because we also, for example, want digits or special characters in there that should be allowed as well. This doesn't work. Why not? Don't answer.
We don't understand why.
Wait. We don't understand. Why not? So now, what do we do when we don't understand? Right, we go with, we jump to the mailing list. What else? What's the other option? What's the other option? We ask Damien if he's not in the room. What else? We open. Sorry.
Debug.
It's a bug, right? No, debug, right? But before you debug, what did we do when we looked at just what's the difference between star and plus? We inspected exactly, or we just open the browser and then see what exactly is that. Inspect that. So let's inspect this, right? So we have quote S parser not. I inspect that. That's a PP not parser. I don't know what that is. Let me browse that. Okay. The not predicate, a parser that succeeds whenever its delegate does not, right? So this one, the resulting parser will succeed when the delegate parser does not succeed, but consumes no input, right? So this is where the difference is, right? So then we say, okay, so what is the other option? Well, I don't know, so I want to go here and take a look and say, what are the different possible operations? And then I say, okay, there's not. And then I say, well, there's negate. And let's take a look quickly at the implementation of negate. So is not, right? I want to succeed when the one that I have when I want the return to succeed when I don't succeed. So I myself not. But then followed by anything. Right, so I want to consume the next character. This is super cool. Right? So the difference between negate and not is something that you have to remember because you will most probably stumble over it quite often, right? In most cases, you most probably will want to use negate, right? Because that's something that consumes, so that means that you are forwarding your execution. Yes, Igor. So Igor has a hunch, okay? I don't know what it is. I want to go and inspect that. Okay, so this is in the predicate parser, right? And I learned that any is on this part here, right? So I have on message, negated message. So I have to go now on the instance side, blah, blah, blah. And then I have here on the parse, and as you see here, we're talking about if it's at the end, no, then, right? We just look at one character. So your hunch is correct. So the terminals, except for the string one, basically, is one character, right? Which is the cool thing about it because it means it's the most, it's the unit of consumption if it's one character. Yeah.
Then S parser.
Yeah.
And then not. And then followed by this edge. If you take only one character out.
No. If it's the not is applied to everything. Right? This will advance only one character. But the parser will be applied will be itself is the whole parser, right? So if you apply it for a large thing, that's fine. So the negation can be, oh, I don't want to parse, let's say Romeo and Juliet. So the parser that parses Romeo and Juliet, the whole text of Romeo and Juliet. And then I say not, and then I give it one character. And that's fine, right? So it will try to parse whole Romeo and Juliet, it fails, and then it succeeds and consumes only one. So what this, it does not limit the delegate parser. It only limits the consumption step, so that you can control at very, very fine levels, right? So the negation can be on a very complex parser. That means something like, I don't want Smalltalk, I want something else. So it can be the complete Smalltalk parser in here. And still, the next consumed character is only one. Mm-hmm. Are we on the same page here? So who has questions? Who's confused? You're still confused, OK. Do we have other confused people? We're still confused. What's the confusion about? So you didn't understand the negate, right? You?
I was starting to understand. I'm just looking at the bigger picture. That I'm sort of understanding.
Did you sort of understand that, right?
Sort of understand.
So we have here somebody that does not understand really what negate is about. Anybody else that does not understand negate? One, two, three. So who can explain it better than me then? So somebody else must explain to these guys because we want to move on, and negate is really important. Okay, you try. So Nuri will try to say what he does not understand. Yes?
So negate.
What's the difference? Let's start with the difference between not and negate.
It consumes one character if its delegate fails.
Right, exactly. It consumes one character if its delegate fails. You get it right. It does not consume, right? So because a parser usually is made of two things. First is the consumption part, and the other one is the correctness part, right? So you can sometimes advance even if something is not correct, or you can stall even if something is correct, right? The two are not the same, right? So this is what we've stumbled into, right? So not is just about the correctness, and negate bundles the correctness together with advancement, okay? Are we fine?
Yep. And so what happened with my example was...
You stalled, and you tried
it looped.
It looped, basically. It didn't advance.
Because it's not consumed.
Well, actually, yeah, because you just finished it with that, yes.
Maybe I didn't catch. What does this NF parser arrow second mean?
That's why I kept on trying to tell you. So whenever you see any magic like this, the first thing you do is you go to PP predicate object parser on the class side, and then you check what that thing is. Now, what would you think this means? Parse any? Any input character that you get, you should succeed and parse it.
And the second?
Sorry?
The second.
Right. Let's forget about that at the moment, just for a while. OK? Let's take this one out. Other questions, yes? There was a question? Question? I thought there was a question. Yes? Sorry? So here we have our parser for string becomes like this. We start with the quote. We have quote, the parser that parses quote, we negate that multiple times, and then we end with the quote, right? So the delegate, when you said negate, the delegate is the result of this one, right? This means it should not be any of this, and I will continue consuming that. Okay? Other questions? It's fine, can we move on? Okay. You have it running in your workspace? So let's see, right? We print it, and this is the interesting thing, right? It's not about whether it works or not. By default, you also already get a default resolution of what's going on, right? This we will see. This is really, really crucial. Every parser is an input, some machinery, and an output, right? This is important. We will do that something. We will do something with it. Right. Right, it's just there, right? That's the basic principle. So if you just forget about what you might have known before, just approach it in a pure programming fashion, it becomes really, really trivial. So you see here, what we got back is the array formed by the character quote, another array with three characters x, y, z inside, and another character quote, right? So we have an array with three things. Inside, we have another three things. Right? So we move on. your task is still not ready because, if I recall correctly, you also should build the parser and for a number. And this one should parse something like this, minus 123.45e minus 2.
How about the string with
embedded quotes? No, but we get to that a bit later. You'll have to do that too. Well, if you want to do it now and you have spare time, then you do it now. But I promise that we will have to do that a bit later.
I love the comment.
Sorry, yes? Just I'm coming.
Who can I use the message like min or max that receives a parameter inside if I want to concatenate, for example, in the previous, in our implementation, when you do
quote.
Quote, star, etc. If I want to do quote, star, max, 6, for example.
Yes.
Who can I do that?
How do you think you could do that? So first of all, what is star? What does star mean?
I should maybe use parentheses.
What does star mean?
Multiple times.
No, I don't know what that means, multiple. Don't be fuzzy. It's in there. It's in the implementation. It's not a black box. It's a white box. You should be able to look into it and run it. So we looked into star. The implementation of star said minimum zero time, maximum max value of small integer, right?
Anyone who had many on your first slide.
Yeah, I know. But any is different than many, right? So many was the star.
Means zero or one. Many means
star.
One.
Right. More than zero. Well, okay, more than one. You're right. You're right. Okay. Okay, that's true. Zero or many, I should have said it.
Any is good.
But any, you would confuse it with the any as
yeah,
parser.
No, any
so that's not good, right?
Right.
So, Mariano, are we fine? So then we let's create Mariano's operator. Mariano, we want to create Mariano's operator that takes two parameters for lower boundary and upper boundary, right? So if I would have to do that, I would go to, by the way, everybody else has a job to do. No, joking. So if we look at the implementation of star, right? Right, and now we want to implement, oh, let's take a look at plus, because that one is. Right, so this is plus, right? So I see, oh, it's using mean max, right? Mean something. Oh, I can see there's already a mean max. Right, so basically, instead of having star, and you want to specify how many do you really want, then you will replace star with the call to mean max, and you'll pass whatever parameters you want. Are we in agreement? Yes? Thank you. Anybody else with a question? Who managed to parse a natural number? So who managed to parse a natural number?
I am, but not in PetitParser.
No. So who managed to implement more than that? Ay, ay, ay.
We managed to parse Smalltalk strings.
Okay, so we have strings. So who's still working on strings then? Okay, you're finished. Okay, who's working on numbers? Very good. How far are we and what are the problems? How far are we? So who has anything running? Yes, what is running? It's not a problem, right? We don't care about the result. We just care about, we want to see the result. I mean, look at this one. It's a mess. We don't care about getting the number at the moment. So you can parse that. Who else can parse that? One, two, three, yeah, no. Sorry? Optional, exactly. That's the word, right? So if you want something to be optional, then it should be optional. So that means something like this. So if right? So this should work. So anybody that had it working, what have you written there? So who has anything working? Right there? So how do we start?
Character minus optional.
Wait, so. Can I have your attention, please? So we have to be organized if you want to move on together. Otherwise, we're just going to, everybody's rumbling, and then it's moving all directions. So I need your feedback so that we can move on faster. So please tell me what should be in there. What's the first thing that we have? For a number, what's the first possible character? Is not a parenthesis. Parenthesis is not part of a number. It's part of an expression. I have an optional dash, right? So how would I write that one, right? So I have an optional dash. How do I write that? Dollar minus what?
As
parser, never forget that. And then you say optional, right?
But you can have a plus too, so you have to put parentheses.
We don't, okay, we don't have a plus at the moment.
We do test-driven development, so you succeeded.
This is the test, right? This is the test. In fact, if we would do test, if you would be really faithful for test-driven development, you were really eager to say that this is optional.
Ego just won.
No, no.
Right? Why? It is. Because it's test-driven, so this should be fail even without the optional. This should work without the optional.
Without optional, yes.
Yes. That's why I said that if you would be faithful to test-driven, we would not even write that. Okay. What's next?
Digit.
Not digits, because I don't have that. I
Hash
have
digit.
To construct.
Digit plus.
So, you tell me, please.
There is an extra.
Sorry, I forgot your name.
Rich?
Yes.
Reg.
Reg?
Reg.
Please tell me, what should I write? Tell me, what should I type? I need to know what to type.
Well, I know you want digit, but I don't. Is it all count
digits? Right, so we have digit. This is one. Then I need to get the parser out of it, right? So I need as parser. And then what? How many digits do I need there?
At least one.
At least one, right? It cannot be not having one. So this means it's the plus operator. Right? What else? What comes afterwards?
Parenthesis,
okay, beautiful. What do I put in the parenthesis? Right, so I have now the whole thing is optional, right? Everything that follows after this number is optional, and it starts with a dot, right? So it will be an optional, the whole parenthesis is optional now, right? So comma, because it's a sequence, so it's followed by, and then what? Is it dollar digit, like that? Oh, it's hash. Right. S parser, right? Plus. And then? Comma. So? Do we put it here or where?
After the last optional.
So what, any other opinions? Exactly. I know.
Do you want to be right or do you want to be happy?
So it can be here, right? So we can have something like this. And then what? Dollar what?
To be inside, because if it doesn't have a floating point, it shouldn't take
it. It makes no sense. That's I believe with that, yeah. I would concur. So then I have an E, right? As parser. And then?
Comma.
There's a dollar E, right?
Dollar dash.
Dollar dash as parser, right?
Dollar dash as parser.
Optional.
Right, and then?
Any number of digits.
Digit
dash.
As parser plus.
Digit plus. Mm-hmm. No, you don't need as parser.
You do. Always need as parser.
Not on symbols.
Yes.
Yes.
Always need as parser. Now, is this correct now? So that means that to me, this is what it's here it says, right? So here it says, so which, where is the, which is the optional part?
Before E, put the parenthesis, and then here.
Okay. Because E can be with or without minus. Can be plus 2. Can be without the minus. Mm-hmm. So the minus is optional.
Right, so there is an extra dollar minus as parser, comma, vertical bar.
That's for this whole thing is optional. Okay. Right, sorry?
It's dollar minus as parser, vertical bar, dollar plus as parser, close parenthesis, optional.
Ah,
now you're forgetting an S parser.
Thank you. We happy? So let's see. We print it. Woohoo!
Yeah.
That's cool. Now, I hate it.
Yeah.
What's wrong?
It's way too complicated.
Sorry? So how did you refactor it? Wait, decimal, exponent, and number. Right? But before that, sorry? Like what? So let's see, I mean, it's simple refactoring that we're trying to do, right? So let's take a look. I love this, I mean, if the text this, the text editor is good for something, is that it shows me that I have duplicates.
Yeah.
Right? So at least this part I should move somewhere else, right? So that's, I call it a natural. Is that okay? Right, so we just call this one natural, and then I have natural. Right, so now I print this, it's the same thing, that's fine. So I'm getting there, it's much better. Now, what I don't like, so you said that you have decimal and exponential, or what was it? The whatever comes after, like after, like this parenthesis here, right? This one, no? So I would take this one and I call this one, I call it E. Right? So if I print it, I still get what I want. And now I can pretty much read it. Right? So I have my natural, which is as many digits as I, like at least one digit. I have the E thing that depends on natural, and then I have number that combines natural and E together. Right? And then I have my parser. And that's it. Questions? Does everybody have this one in your in the workspace? So who does not have it in the workspace?
Can you bring the result?
Wait, just a second. Everybody says, who does not have this in the workspace? Please take the time, 3 minutes, and type it in the workspace. That's why you work in pairs, so that you can focus only on that. So.
Yeah, copy paste doesn't work between the.
Yeah, I know, but don't work in pairs like that. You know, one can prototype and just drive, and the other one drives down. I will print it for you, Mariano. Here is the result.
Uh-huh.
You're welcome. You would split E into fraction and everything, but there is, to me, there is no duplication, so it's still fine. Okay, I would keep it like that.
We could have a sign actually, because we use it twice.
You could use it twice, right? The sign could use it twice, right? But at the moment, you still don't have this one because in your grammar, this is a different sign than the other one because that one has plus as well, and this one does not have plus, so it's not the same. So you see, it's not quite something that you might quite reuse, or you have to take another decision at a different level, which means what's my exact grammar. Right, but let's keep it like that at the moment. Are we fine?
I'm just trying to
Yeah, please type it in. Take the time. So we still wait a bit to that you type it in. Anybody else? Everybody's having it in the same workspace. So it must be in the same workspace, because I want you to build on top of it, and we will build the whole parser that we mentioned before. These are two small sub-parsers for that. There is, the vertical bar has a different semantics. So slash is either the first one, and if the first one fails, then it tries the second one. The vertical one, it's a very cool parser that is an XOR. So only one should succeed. This is what Lukas is using when he's embedding two languages that might have like SQL and Smalltalk. And then he's trying to parse the whole thing as Smalltalk, and if it parses, it's fine. If he tries, and then he tries to parse as SQL, and if it parses, then it will raise you an error because it's ambiguous. Yeah. Very cool. But so anyway, for most,
it would work here.
It would work, but it's more computation, right? So it must. It's a choice. It's a normal choice. It's if the first one succeeds, then you stop. Yeah. If the first one fails, then you continue. With the vertical bar, is you try the first one. If it succeeds, then the second one must fail. Uh-huh. Right? So it's a must fail, right? XOR. Right. This is an OR. The other one is XOR. Ready we are.
Yes.
Very cool. So everybody is up to date. Very cool. So we move on. Yeah, we move on a bit. Just one small exercise, right? So we have the next thing. So up to now, we really focused on combining our parser, right? So building the parser up. So as soon as we had anything at the output, we were happy, right? Like we just had something there, and okay, fine. As long as we had anything at the output. On the output. So let's see again, right? So I said that if I executed this string here, I got the mumbo jumbo here, right? It's a large array of things. I don't exactly know what it is. So let's see what happens if I put an error in there. Like, by the way, let's see what happens if I put this small error in there, right? It still executes. Okay. And the reason why it executes is I will put the error here. Right? So it says it expects something, right? I get an error. So now let's inspect this. So the result is not a string, but it's an actual object, right? So it's PP failure. This is a very important object you should get familiar with, right? So at least once you should have seen it. Okay? So PP failure. Basically to a... So if you take a look at it, You can ask it if it's is petit failure. So to any result, you can ask is petit failure. Right? It's a polymorphic to object. Right? So this is implemented in object. So by default, it's returning false. And if you have a failure, then this is how you can check whether you have a failure or not. Okay. So, but let's suppose that this is correct. Now what we want is we want to affect this to return, to get something meaningful out of it, right? Something that we can play with afterwards, right? So for this, we have the actions. So actions is like logic that is applied. It has effect on the result of the parser, right? So this one is applied on the output of the parser, okay? So the regular parser that we just built produces something, and then you can wrap it in a different parser that will transform that output into something else. So let's take a look at a couple of things. So this is a crucial one. So this the transformation. So that's a basic transformation that transforms the result, right? So you remember that you saw this in the implementation of negate. You saw equal higher than second. Right, which basically means evaluate the second, give me the second element in the array, in the resulting array, right? Because we only care about the result of the any as parser character.
To
Tudor, just because it was really funny when I saw it, and because Igor's a very clever guy, can I show you how he won the number parsing thing? You go back to your workspace, and I'll show you what to type.
So show me how she won.
Okay, so open square bracket.
Sorry?
Square bracket, colon I, vertical bar.
Yeah.
Space, number, read from, colon I.
Yes. You mean number with capital N, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I.
Thank you.
As parser.
Yes, as parser.
That works. That's good. Yeah. So, but anyway, so this means that you will get a block with one input. That is the array, the result, right? And you typically name that token. And then you can play with the result. So this is this transformation that is after the at the end of it. Okay. Then we have some simpler ones like flatten. So flatten is a parser that says, okay, you know, just if, for example, if you have characters, like an array of characters, flatten will return you a string.
And if I have array of arrays?
We'll take a look at the implementation of flatten. Okay? If you have token, is the same as flatten, only it returns you not a string, but it will return you, or similar to flatten, but it returns you a token, a PP token, that has also the position, which we saw how important it is to know the position when you parse something, because if you build the debugger in a generic way, right, then it's totally, you know, then it just works with any language. Isn't it like that, Elliot?
Mm-hmm.
Right? If you build the debugger in a generic way that just depends on a token that is produced by a parser, then you can just highlight anything you, whatever you have, right? So this is what token does for you. So if you say, I want to tokenize the result of something, it will give you back a token with the position, the start and the end in the input stream of that of what you matched. We will see a bit later. And then we also have something like trim, which consumes, let's say in this case, trim consumes all the white spaces to the left and to the right, for example. So if you now I would like you to take a look here in the operations mapping. So if you open your system browsers on PP parser in the protocol operations mapping, you have, for example, the implementation of equal higher than. And this one will return you a PP action parser. So you see, it's all about decorating and composing parsers. It's all about objects. You put objects together, and all these objects will have different semantics. Questions? Which one?
I've got flatten, and then I'm
token. Oh, this one. Flatten, token, trim, and this one. These are, let's say, you can go a long way with just these. There are many more others, right? So you don't have to write it down. You only have to do is write this one down in the operations mapping category. OK, so now let's play with this one. What I want to flatten this part here. So I want to get an actual string out of it, right? So what I will do now, so I have this one, string as parser, so dollar quote as parser, negate star, dollar quote parser, right? So then if I want to do that, I simply add at the end, that's a nice binary operator, it has a token, and I say, please give me token second, right, here. And to this star, I tell it, please give me flatten. And if you'll execute this, you'll get a nice string. So please try it out. So first one will flatten the whole thing. So we will have an array with three elements. And the one in the middle will not be an array, which will be a string. And this one here will just tell you, I'm only interested in the known quotes. Sorry?
You can replace this block
with hash second, exactly. But for example reasons, it's better to be explicit.
Okay.
Are we there? Who still has problems? Questions?
I'm just trying. So when we do the
flatten, yes. Let me check. So now we have a question here, right? So I have this one, right? So this is the string. Now I will say flatten, right? So now I want to see string parse XYZ, right? Like that, right? I should start to parse that. And if I parse, I get an array, right? The first I have character quote, a string, and character dot character quote. Then if to this whole thing I say that I only want the second one, then you have your nice small talk string. The block, so I needed this one, right? So I need the whole thing. I don't care about the first and the end quote.
Well, no, I remember what you get back. Right? What you get back, the structure that you get back reflects the structure of your parser.
Right.
So the structure you get is the parser for the result of what chip did, then the result of what the inner thing did, right, which would parse the contents between the quote, and then the quote. So token second is saying, of the whole result, I want the middle one.
Okay,
which is the string, right?
Yeah.
So once you get that middle one, that's broken up into an array, right?
So if I inspect this, now I'm inspecting it, I have an array with three things inside. I have the character quote, the actual string now because it's flattened, and another character quote. And now here, from here, I say, oh, I'm only interested in the second one. So.
Yeah.
No, it returned. This one is the same, right?
Oh,
because
okay.
Because of the value implemented in block.
Okay.
In symbol, sorry.
Yes. Okay. That's fine.
Right?
Cool.
On the same page we are?
Yeah.
Everybody? Very cool. So let's try now with trim here. With token. Right? So if I inspect that, I get back not a string, but I get a token. So the token has the position, right? So it starts at the second position because the first one is the character quote, and it ends on the fourth position, right? And then you have your collection, which is the string, right? So you're fine. So that's then to this one, if you say, let's say, to this one. Sorry?
In the inspector select self, that's very nice.
Right? So it's token, and it's just a wrapped around just to have the extra information that you can use around for your debugger, for example.
Yeah.
That's a nice place to use it for. Okay, so I think we got far enough. We have to take a break now. And we reconvene in about half an hour or so. Cool. Yeah, it's not bad. It goes well.
One question to both of you.
Yeah.
Did you see this? This was.
I know that, yes.
Yeah, but this is the one that you said that the name was already used, right?
Yes.
Why? So Smalltalk is 2007, but did this thing. Is it a conflict or what?
No. If they don't have copyright on the name? No, it's fine. And now it works again? Oh, I can see it works.
Gentle with them.